Good afternoon. My name is Cheryl Benton. I'm the Deputy Assistant Secretary of Public Affairs here at the State Department, and I wanted to welcome you to the pre-iftar generation change event, and my role is to introduce Farah Pandith. Farah, as you know, is the catalyst behind this very special event. She was appointed by Secretary Clinton in June of 2009. Her office is responsible for executing the Secretary's vision for engagement with Muslims around the world on a people-to-people and organizational level. Farah has had prominent roles in the private sector, the federal government, and the nonprofit sector. At the State Department, she was, prior to this appointment, was a senior advisor for the Bureau of European and Eurasian Affairs, working on outreach to the Muslim communities in Europe. Prior to joining the State Department, Farah was director for Middle East Regional Initiatives for the National Security Council. She reported directly to the Deputy Assistant to the President and Deputy National Security Advisor for Global Democratic Strategies. Prior to joining the National Security Council, Special Representative Pandith was Chief of Staff for the Bureau for Asia and the Near East for the U.S. Agency for International Development, USAID. Ms. Pandith has also been a Vice President of International Business for ML Strategies in Boston, Massachusetts. She's been a consultant in both the public and nonprofit sectors. She has served on several boards with a focus on international affairs, including the World Affairs Council of Boston, the Council for Emerging National Security Affairs, and the British American Project. She received her AB in Government and Psychology from Smith College, where she was a president of the student body. She received a master's degree from the Fletcher School of Law and Diplomacy at Tufts University, where she specialized in international security studies, Islamic civilizations, and Southwest Asia and international negotiation and conflict resolution. Please put your hands together and help us welcome Farah to the podium.
Thank you, Farah. You're welcome. Well, I am so delighted to see all of your smiling faces at me. I have been looking at your names for several months, trying to figure out who you were and what inspired you to do what you wanted to do. So we've been doing a lot of Googling in our office, a lot of reading, and I feel really honored that you came today towards the end of Ramadan, the beginning of school for a lot of you, to share tonight with us. This is a really historic moment because you are brought here to the Department of State to tell us how to do things better with your generation. You are reflective of what it means to be change agents and doers and leaders. So for us today, the evening before the iftar will be an opportunity for you to talk to each other, talk to us, ask questions, learn from each other, and I'm hoping develop a network of change agents around the world. What we're going to do tonight is have some guest speakers for the first half an hour, and then break out into breakout sessions, and I'll tell you a little bit about that when the time comes. What I would like to do first is introduce a dear friend of mine, Hera Mustafa, who is sitting right here. I'm going to give you a little bit about her background, and you will see why she is the person that she is, a leader, an inspired person, and somebody who is definitely a change agent in many different ways. Hera is currently the senior advisor on the Middle East to the Vice President of the United States. She is an American diplomat whose family's story was the subject of the documentary film, An American Hero. She will tell you about her personal journey, but let me just say that she graduated from high school in 91, earned her undergraduate degree from Georgetown in 95, where she studied national security and the Middle East. She also received a master's degree in international relations from the Woodrow Wilson School of Public and International Affairs at Princeton University. After graduation, she directed a non-governmental organization for Kurdish studies in the United States, traveled to Bosnia to supervise provincial elections, and served as the senior editor for the Emirates Center for Strategic Studies and Research in Abu Dhabi. Hera joined the U.S. State Foreign Service in 1999 and has served in Athens, Washington, D.C., and Iraq. She is an inspiration to me, and I know she will be an inspiration to you. Please welcome Hera Mustafa.
Thank you, dear Farah. That was very kind. Assalamu alaikum. For those of you who are fasting, this is probably the last thing you want to do, is listen to a panel of people speak right before you break fast. So I will keep this very short. Welcome to the State Department. As Farah mentioned, this is my home agency. I'm a U.S. diplomat currently on detail in Vice President Biden's office. I was born in Iraq, and we left at when I was very young because of the political situation in Iraq. We landed in the snowy banks of Minot, North Dakota, when I was three. And we literally started from scratch. My parents took three jobs each just to try to provide for us. We didn't take anything for granted. Finished high school, college, graduate school. And in 1999, I joined the U.S. Foreign Service. My first assignment was to Athens, Greece. Even though I spoke Arabic and Kurdish and Turkish and Farsi, the Foreign Service decided to send me to Greece. Don't ask me why. That's where I went, via Greek language training. But then eventually, I also worked in Beirut, in Mosul, Iraq, at the National Security Council, working on Israeli-Palestinian issues and Iran. And currently, I'm with Vice President Biden, working on the Middle East and South Asia, so Afghanistan, Pakistan, and India. I'm happy to tell you more about my background, but what I thought I would do is share with you some of the lessons that I have personally picked up along the way. Your generation, I'm sure you've heard, is one of the luckiest generations because you have so many things, so many resources at your disposal. You have access to technology. You have access to the media. You can spread information faster than any generation before you could with just a click of a button. So in many ways, you're a very lucky generation. But you're also a generation facing significant challenges, both here at home in the United States and abroad. Now, Farah has traveled to 25 different countries, meeting with Muslim communities around the world. And she hears from them what Muslims feel in terms of their identity, how they communicate their beliefs and their frustrations. Are we, as Americans, getting our message across effectively? Your generation is able to use the resources that you have to spread your story and to spread our story. And that's something that you can do effectively. In terms of lessons learned, here are just some of my own personal lessons that I've learned. I have five. One, never let anyone tell you that you can't do something because of your background or because of where you're from. Now, on this, I have a story. When I first joined the Foreign Service, and again, I was going to Greece, and somebody who was working at the State Department had heard that I was born in Iraq and asked me to come in to talk about the situation in Iraq, to share, you know, thoughts on what was happening. So I went in, and afterwards he said, "So where would you eventually like to serve?" And I said, "Well, in the Middle East. I would like to serve in the region that gave me birth, representing the region, or representing the country that gave me freedom." And he said, "Oh, you'll never work in the Middle East. You were born there. You'll never work there." So from that day, I strove to prove him wrong. And I have. So lesson number one, never let anyone tell you that you can't do something. Lesson number two, embrace your difference. Don't hide from it. Again, I speak to a lot of incoming Foreign Service officers, and many of the ones who are from, were born in a different country or come from a different background, come up to me and say, "How can I prove that I'm American enough for this job?" And I always tell them, "You deserve to be at the table just as any other person there is. You offer something different, and it's because of that that we're a better country, and it's also because of that that you should hold your head up high and speak with confidence and speak with authority. My third lesson, learn skills. You can have a fantastic degree from a wonderful university, but it's your skill or skills that will set you apart, whether it's your language skills, whether it's your mechanical skills, your technological skills, whatever it is, acquire skills. You can have somebody with a great degree who doesn't have any skills. Then you can have somebody with fantastic skills who might not have a degree. So regardless of where you are in your career, find time to continue studying, whether it's in morning language class, an afternoon, evening language class, take an economics course. Whatever it is, continue to acquire the skills, because that's what will set you apart. Four, always be transparent. As you know, our society is too open. We're already talking about technology and how interconnected we are. Our society is too open for us to play the Machiavellian games and think that we'll come out ahead. I find that people appreciate the transparency, and I believe that you will be rewarded if your actions match what it is that you say. And five, always take time to mentor. You are young Muslim Americans, and right below you is another set of younger Muslim Americans who are aspiring to be just like you. You're never, ever too busy to take 5 minutes to just talk to them. How did you get to where you are? What do you recommend that they do to try to strive and achieve and accomplish? So always take time to mentor. So in a nutshell, those are my five lessons that I've picked up along the way. I look forward to speaking with you more later this evening and at the Secretary's iftar dinner.
Hera, thank you so much. I know that you may have to escape to go finish what you need to be doing for the Vice President, but please stay as long as you wish, and thank you very much for taking time today. I'm going to ask speakers to actually come to the microphone because I think it is it's better for the cameras to be able to record, and I'm sorry, Hera, that I did not know that ahead of time.
Totally okay.
I think that we have a video of all set up and ready to go. We don't yet. Okay. All right, here we go. I have the distinct pleasure of introducing somebody who is a friend and has been a colleague and a friend for several years. Before he got rock star status and as he was moving up the chain, I met Dr. Al-Mutawa about 4 or 5 years ago when I was working at the White House, actually. And he started to tell me about this thing that he had launched, and my eyes became big, and I was so interested in what he was doing. And I'm absolutely amazed that in the course of a very short period of time, his idea has taken off. I'm going to give you a little bit of his background, but it is truly an honor to have him here with us today. He flew in from London this afternoon so that he could speak to all of you, and I want to thank you very much for that. Dr. Naif Al-Mutawa is a Kuwaiti clinical psychologist and creator of The 99, which is in your packets, the first group of comic superheroes born of an Islamic archetype. Recently, Forbes named The 99 as one of the top 20 trends sweeping the globe, and most recently, President Obama made a special mention about The 99 superheroes and its creator, Naif Al-Mutawa, in his speech at the President's Entrepreneurship Summit held here in Washington this past April. The president commented on the 99 for capturing the imaginations of young people through the messages in the 99. The 99 has been recognized by media outlets around the world, including CNN, The Huffington Post, Al Jazeera, The New York Times, The Wall Street Journal, and The Washington Post. Naif has a PhD in clinical psych from the Long Island University, where he also earned a master's degree in clinical psychology. He holds a master's in organizational psychology from Teachers College, Columbia University, and an MBA also from Columbia. He earned his undergraduate degree from Tufts University, where he triple majored in clinical psychology, English literature, and history. Naif is the recipient of the United Nations Alliance of Civilizations Marketplace of Ideas Award, the Schwab Foundation Social Entrepreneurship Award presented at the 2009 World Economic Forum in the Middle East, the Elliot Pearson Award for Excellence in Children's Media, and a UNESCO Prize for Literature in the Service of Tolerance. Naif has presented at numerous TED Talks, and I know you guys know all about TED. I had the pleasure of hearing him in Oxford this past July. Out of the many people who spoke at TED, He was one of the first to get a standing ovation. And by the way, the two standing ovations were two Muslims who had two very different things to say. His message speaks to all of us, whether you're Muslim or not. And I'm really proud and honored that you joined us today. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. There's so much out there about the 99. I'll just spend a little bit on that, and then I'll talk to you about some failures I've had along the way instead of the successes, because that's the part that you never really get to speak about. The 99 has grown from an idea to over $30 million in financing, TV series that'll be in your living room this TV season here in the US, a theme park, comic books in 8 languages, soon games online, and it grew from just one man with an idea in a cab in London in what I call a pilgrimage that every Kuwaiti must make from Edgware Road to Harrods, and has grown into something that beyond my expectations, and presently we're actually even in talks for a film in Hollywood. And I'm happy to talk about that at a later point, but I want to talk about what came before the 99, because I think that's the stage that you guys are at right now. I'm Kuwaiti, my kids are American, I'm not. They were all born in New York, all by accident, of course, all 5 of them. And I grew up, my parents sent me by accident to a Jewish summer camp in New Hampshire. And they didn't know, I was there, I went for 10 years. By the time I was there for the 7th or 8th year, I figured it out. And I should have known in year one because I was the only one that kept kosher at the camp. But the camp was called Camp Robin Hood, and I said, you could have called it Camp Robin Yehud, at least then we would have known that that it was a Jewish summer camp. But I grew up going there for 10 years. My own boys now go there, and it was an amazing experience. And this was pre-satellite television in Kuwait. And you can tell from my height and weight right now what I must look like when I was 8. I was like a box. And the kids used to make me point up to the sky and say, boss, boss, the plane, the plane. I had no idea what that was until years later. I'm like, wait a minute. My journey with writing and tolerance started half my years ago. I'm 39 years old now. When I was 19 at Tufts University, an imam changed my life. Because growing up in Kuwait, Islam was always shown as a black and white thing. And there's one thing I knew about myself, I don't do black and white. Islam could not count on me if this was Islam. And I was very vociferous about that. I had no issue. I had no guilt about it. Maybe for my mom a little bit. But the Imam Talal, who was doing his PhD at the Harvard Divinity School, came and spoke to us at Tufts. And he said something that pretty much changed my life. Because he said this. He said, if you asked me if riba was haram, usury, or paying interest on a loan, I would tell you yes, and I would quote you chapter and verse. But if I didn't pay interest on my car loan, I couldn't be here today to talk to you about Islam. And I was like, wait a minute. That's a gray area. I can live here. I don't have to have other people dictate to me what Islam is or isn't. I can make my own decisions. And I believe strongly if God had meant for us to, because one of the lessons that I learned growing up was you have to copy before you think. Al-naqla qabla al-aql. And my response to that is if God had wanted us to be parrots, he would have given us feathers and beaks instead of free will and a mind. My first adventure, which was my failure, it was a success until I made my own mistake, was something called, it was a series of books, the one they wore from UNESCO called To Bounce or Not to Bounce. Basically, a man had gotten fired in Kuwait because of his religion. And that was only half the bad part of the story. The worst part, could be a worse part, is the guy that fired him gave out leaflets to the local community apologizing that had he known this guy's religion, he wouldn't have hired him to begin with. And I thought, my God, where'd I just land after college? I wrote about it, it didn't hit the spot, and I wrote and illustrated, I can't draw, so it was done in symbols, and my circles kind of look like triangles. But I wrote and illustrated my first children's book, but I didn't intend it for children. I did it for adults, because back then there were things going on in Bosnia and Rwanda, and very simply the book was called To Bounce or Not to Bounce, about a land called Bouncy Land, where everybody's round. In that society, they judge you based on two values, how high you bounce and how fast you roll. That's it. But the main character is born as a half circle, can't do either, he's ostracized, his parents are ashamed, he tries to change himself, doesn't work, until the very end, where his difference ends up saving everybody, and forces society to reevaluate the importance of diversity. There's a flood, they're all round, they can't control themselves with the water, but he's boat-shaped and he saves them one by one. So it's the story of, a Muslim among Christians, somebody short among tall people, whatever you want. It's everybody's, it's done in symbols, so it's everybody's story. It's my story, your story. And that book, the book did very well and led to a 3-book contract. So I think it became the only children's book in the world that I'm aware of that was financed through a real estate ad. That's the only way I could raise the money for it. And so I put it out. Book 2 came out, and this is where I started having my beginnings of my failure. You have to understand, this first book came out, I was 25. Book 2, 26, was called What's in a Color, which was about part 2. He goes to a land called Rainbow Land, where they're all half circles, so he's expecting that they're going to accept him immediately, but they don't. Because in Rainbow Land, they judge you according to the color of your bow tie and where it is on the rainbow. So red is better than orange, better than yellow, all the way down to violet, the worst place in society. And they have marriage laws, like any good society might, right? If you have a red bow tie, you can't marry anybody with a blue ribbon, because red and blue gives you purple, the last place on the rainbow. Cross-cultural, cross-religious, cross-whatever you want marriages. And when he asked them why they live their life in that way, typically people who do always put words in God's mouth, but of course I don't mention God in the books, they point up to the sky at the rainbow and say it's the natural order of things. To which he points to the reflection of the rainbow in the river, and what's on top is now on the bottom, and he shows them that nobody's better than anybody based on that alone. That I had the beginnings of my problems, because I was angry young man. I could never do starving artist, as you can tell, but I could do angry young man pretty well. I used the word Qos Qazah, which means rainbow in Arabic, on the title. And I was told that I should not use that word, because Qazah is one of the names of the devil. And I said, well, is that the law? Do I have to follow this law? They said, no, but we strongly recommend it. They use the word Qos Matar, which is actually the translation of the English word rainbow into Arabic, then using the Arabic word. And I said, no, I'm going to just do it this way. And they let it go. Book 3 got banned. But book 3 got banned because of me, because I wouldn't compromise. And this is the lesson I want to share with you. And it became the subject of my failure essay when I applied to Columbia Business School. In book 3, Bouncy Jr. sees a picture of his dad next to a character 10 times the size of his dad, wearing a necktie, not a bow tie. He's like, there's two new things here, size, and he gets, oh, this is really cool, where is it? This is a giant. And the dad explains, you know, they're not giants, they're from Thailand, spelled T-I-E land. And in Thailand, they have this tradition that you can never buy a new tie. You have to wear the tie of your father who wears the tie of his father before him. So he wants to visit, they go visit, and for some reason, nobody knows why, all the Thailanders are now the same size as the Bouncy Landers. But because of their laws, their ties are now disproportionate to their body size. So when they roll, their ties get under them, make them slow and inefficient. And when they bounce, their ties cover their eyes, they don't know where they're going to land. And those that take off their ties in protest get shunned to a different part of the island. And so Bouncy Jr. has now solved two societal problems, asked to see this law, and the law says you must wear of the ties of your fathers, not the ties of your fathers. So he gets every tailor in town, every tie in town, and from the same material, they cut out new ties to better serve their modern day needs. So I get asked point blank, this is about the Quran, isn't it? I said, huh? Because I wrote that book the day Hamid, my first son, was born. I wrote it about the tug that's inevitable between father and son when, you know, I'm 52 and he's 25 or 26, whatever the numbers are going to be. But that's what I wrote it for. But the way I wrote those books were they were meant to reflect the reader's soul. So I said to the guy, I said, if somebody reads this in Tokyo or Washington or Russia, are they going to think Quran? No. That didn't fly. They wanted me to change some words. I wouldn't do it. So the book just stayed on my shelf. And that's the lesson, that's the failure. Because that message could have gotten out if I didn't get in the way of myself. Sometimes you have to go back and kind of try to find that compromise. And for me, the 99 has been just an amazing experience because I came back, I quit writing at 27. 5 years I didn't write. I wrote for myself, but I was like, you know what? I'm not gonna do this. It's not worth it. But I came back at 32 armed with 99 superheroes and have been having similar problems, but have been dealing with them in a very different way. It's been 7 years of very, very hard work and a lot of fun. And I'll end with just this story is that when I first started, I kept being pushed, you know, did you ask any religious scholars, did you ask any scholars about what you're doing, you know, is it okay? And I'd avoid that question like the plague because I didn't want to get caught up in the politicking, not yet. And so if I get pushed, I'd say, well, you know, I spoke to Emo Phillips. They say, Sheikh Phillips, we haven't heard of him. I said, that's a good thing because he's a comedian. So what do you mean? I said, well, Emo Phillips used to say that every night till the age of 10, he used to pray to God for a bicycle. And at 10, he realized that God didn't work that way. So he stole the bicycle and started praying for forgiveness. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. And welcome. I'm so happy to see you. Thank you. If you look around to the right and the left of you, you may see faces that you've met before. But I want to tell you, I told you earlier, we spent the summer Googling and finding information about some of you. And I just want to call out, not names, but some of you here have been called out by Oprah. Some of you have been on the front pages of the New York Times. Some of you have started your own companies. Some of you have created apps for the iPhone. You're really cool people in this room. And I'm so honored to have you here with us. To me, you're superheroes. Talk to Naif about that. Okay. Some of your superheroes are up here on the podium. I'd like to introduce the co-founders of the New Muslim Cool. Hana Siddiqui Hernandez was born in London, England. She is a co-producer of the award-winning feature documentary, New Muslim Cool, which launched the 2009 Point of View series on PBS. As an undergraduate, she designed her own interdisciplinary major and wrote her thesis paper entitled Muslim Culture, Identity Politics, and Hip-Hop in America. In 2001 to 2002, she worked as a researcher for Human Rights Watch and a freelance writer. She received a master's degree in Near Eastern Studies from NYU in 2003 after conducting a year-long ethnographic study on the local Halvati Jerahi Sufis. Hannah participated in the 2006 PBS Producers Academy WGBH in Boston and BAVC's 2007 Producers Institute in 2007. She is currently working on a film about a Chinese-American Muslim convert who blogs about her struggle with faith after losing her husband. Kautar Umar is a co-producer of New Muslim Cool and is a New York-based documentary film producer, magazine editor, and photographer. She is editor of the film's forthcoming companion book, Islam Erica, a photo anthology about identity, hip-hop culture, and Muslim youth in America. Kautar holds an MA from American University in Journalism and Public Affairs. Her photography has been exhibited in the Latin Collection Gallery exhibit in New York City and has been featured in a variety of magazines and publications, including Tokian Magazine and American Muslim Woman Negotiating Race, Class, and Gender Within the Ummah. Her photography will also appear in the forthcoming book, World Religions, Western Traditions, Third Edition, edited by Oxtoby and Hussein for Oxford University Press. Kautar has written for Essence and YM magazine. She serves as a contributing editor for ISNA's Islamic Horizons magazine, where she developed and edited the historic 2005 issue, Return to Roots, about Islam in Black America. She is also an editor for the forthcoming anthology, Crossing Limits, Poetry from American Muslims and American Jews. It is my pleasure and my honor to introduce them here tonight.
Assalamu alaikum and good evening. My name is Kautar Umar.
And I'm Hannah Siddiqui, and we want to welcome you to Generation Change.
In 2005, Hannah and I were invited to co-produce a film that took us on a five-year adventure through the industrial remnants of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, to Muslim hip-hop concerts in Berkeley, California, to historic mosques in Harlem, New York, in an effort to chronicle the life of a Puerto Rican-American Muslim rapper, Hamza Perez, coming of age in a post-9/11 America.
New Muslim Cool, which launched the 2009 POV series on PBS, is the first feature film to tell the story of a young indigenous American Muslim convert and his adventures with profiling, hip-hop, faith, and being Muslim in America. While New Muslim Cool examines life through the eyes of one young Muslim artist, there is a generation of American Muslims from which Hamza comes. They're devoted to Islam, popular culture, civic engagement, technology, politics, and defining American Islam for themselves.
Today, it's that generation, our generation, facilitating change. We are designing, shouting, inventing, shaping, creating, challenging, and defining our own identity. In this room alone, we are graced with young lawmakers and entrepreneurs, community organizers, religious leaders, and artists, all whom make up the fabric of America and are dedicated to making positive change in our communities and in our nation.
The writings of scholars, jurists, and travelers like Ibn Battuta and Ibn Taymiyyah express that we gain new levels of understanding when we travel and network with people of different cultures and experiences. During this blessed month of Ramadan, young American Muslims are making headlines for their diverse work, their vision, and making their voices heard.
Young Muslim women and men around the country are working in their own backyards, as well as internationally, on issues of concern to people from various religions and ethnicities.
NPR, CNN, Time Magazine, and The Huffington Post are just a few of the news entities currently following stand-up comedian Aman Ali and filmmaker Bassam Tariq, co-creators of the blog 30 Mosques in 30 Days. They're being covered for their Ramadan road trip visiting mosques in 30 states in order to share with the American public how American Muslims in various locales are balancing their religious and national identities.
San Francisco-born college student Ilana Alaze has been making headlines for her work with the Interfaith Youth Corps' Stranger to Neighbor program and her interfaith project, documenting and sharing immigrant stories through video, poetry, and art. In a recent Washington Post article, Ilana writes, "My family history is an ethnic mix of Palestinian, Russian, Israeli, and Pakistani heritage. This kind of family couldn't have happened anywhere else in the world. I am who I am because of my ancestors' ability to immigrate to the United States. The immigrant experience is what makes me feel distinctively American, despite those who tell me otherwise."
These are just a few of the many examples of our generation breaking barriers using talent and the resources available to us to educate, make ties, and create understanding where there is very little. Today, we are surrounded by our peers, sharing a common thread. We have so much to offer one another based on our specific areas of expertise. This type of networking creates an environment that motivates each individual to go back to his or her respective community much stronger, with a new sense of idealism and hope to continue the work we are doing, no matter how challenging it may be.
During the filming of New Muslim Cool, not only did we document changes in Hamza's life, but we also went through changes of our own. In our third year of filming, Hannah experienced becoming a new mother. Her daughter is being raised in a world that is increasingly shaped by the work we are doing here today. In looking at our children, we realize that our work today is allowing them a greater opportunity to feel comfortable in their own skin as American Muslims, coexisting and contributing to their greater communities and representing the ideals of this nation.
On this note, let's use this opportunity to benefit from what we all bring to the table tonight. Let's get the ideas flowing and create the networks that will allow us to realize our goals. If we want to see change, it will start with us. So let's make change happen.
Thank you.
Thank you for that. That was excellent. Okay, we're about to do breakouts. But before we go to the breakout session, I am so happy and honored to introduce a comedian that you've all heard of. Ahmed Ahmed is a highly acclaimed comedian and was the recipient of the first annual Richard Pryor Award for Ethnic Comedy at the Edinburgh Comedy Festival in Scotland. And he recently appeared on The Tonight Show with Jay Leno. Currently, he is promoting his new film at several festivals, including the Tribeca Film Festival. The film covers his comedy tour through the Middle East, titled Just Like Us. Ahmed was born in Helwan, Egypt. His parents immigrated to the United States when he was 1 month old, and he grew up in Riverside, California. He moved to Hollywood when he was 19 years old to pursue a career as an actor and a stand-up comedian. He attended the American Academy of Dramatic Arts. Ahmed has appeared in numerous films and television series, including Iron Man, The Axis of Evil Comedy Tour, CNN, The View, and NPR, and MTV's Punked. He was featured on the front page of the Wall Street Journal in December of 2001. He is also a regular performer at the Comedy Store in Hollywood and Comedy Cellar in New York City. Recently, he can be seen in the film City of Life, the first feature film to be shot entirely in Dubai, which premiered at the Dubai International Film Festival in 2009. Please welcome Ahmed Ahmed.
Assalamu alaikum. First of all, I'd like to say thanks to be in the presence of all these great speakers, so a big round of applause for the speakers that... I don't feel that accomplished when I'm sitting next to PhDs and all these educated people. I didn't go to college. I guess Hollywood was sort of my college. My father immigrated to the U.S. when I was a month old. He actually, I was born in Helwan, Egypt, right outside of Cairo. He got his immigration papers the day I was born, so he wasn't there for the delivery. But he ran into the hospital room with his papers in hand, yelling, "We're going to America, we're going to America," and picked me up and put me up in the sky like the Lion King or something. And we ended up in Riverside, California. And at the age of 19, I moved to Los Angeles against my parents' will to pursue acting and comedy, which was a tough thing because my father refused to speak to me for about 7 years until I got my first film, and then he was proud all of a sudden. And now he wants to be my opening act, my dad. So I started at the in Los Angeles as an actor, and I was stereotyped quite a bit. I was in a film called Executive Decision where I played terrorist number four. I was in the film Iron Man where I played terrorist number four. I was in several TV shows where I played the cab driver or the sleazy Arab prince or the, you know, money-hungry, you know, Arab slash Muslim that was trying to wreak havoc on the world. And after 7 years, I just got tired of it and quit acting, ran out of money, went back to waiting tables, and eventually became a stand-up comedian. The reason why I became a stand-up comedian was because I was so hungry to have my own voice. And I know a lot of the youth out here, Arabs and especially Muslims, feel like we don't have a voice. And I was trying to figure out the best way to capitalize on that. And I figured, well, why not do stand-up comedy? So, you know, when people are laughing with you, they can't hate you. And that was my whole sort of philosophy behind it, which ended up being true because I was making fun of myself and people were laughing, I think, with me or at me. And the stereotype started sort of fading away. And then 9/11 happened, and everything kind of, you know, we had to start from scratch. Part of the group that I was working with, the Axis of Evil Comedy guys, one was Iranian, two of them were Palestinian, and we oftentimes were being ridiculed by people in the community saying, you guys shouldn't talk about being Arab, you shouldn't talk about being Muslim, and I used to say to myself, well, what else is there to talk about? That's all I know. Right around the time of 9/11, there was quite a bit of ridicule and backlash toward Muslims. I ended up getting detained, profiled, arrested several times, strictly because my name's not only on the no-fly list, but it's on the FBI's most wanted list. Maybe you can help me if I need some assistance. Thanks. So after that, I realized that the backlash wasn't ever really going to go away, and the racial profiling wasn't ever really going to go away. So the comedy shows started to sort of get bigger and better, and we started touring around the U.S. and eventually went to the Middle East as the Axis of Evil Comedy Tour. And we went to 5 different countries. We went to Dubai, UAE, Kuwait City, Kuwait, Cairo, Egypt, Beirut, Lebanon, and Amman, Jordan. That was in 2007. And the demand for stand-up comedy in that part of the world was so big, we didn't realize. We originally had 8 shows that we were supposed to do, and we ended up doing 27 in the course of 30 days. And Showtime Arabia filmed it. It ended up on Showtime Arabia, and we sort of got a kickstart from that. The following year, we went back to the Middle East, and we're doing more shows, and we brought American comedians with us, Italian-American, African-American, Puerto Rican-American. The first single white female came with us to perform. And when I'd come back to the States, all my, you know, Caucasian-American friends would ask me, what were you doing in the Middle East? And I'd say, we were doing comedy shows. And they'd ask me, was it for the troops? And I'd say, no, they're for Arabs and Muslims. And they'd say, in English. And I'd say, yeah, we did our shows in English. And they'd ask me, well, did they get it? And I said, yeah, they got it. And most of America doesn't realize is in the Middle East, there's internet, YouTube, Facebook, branding, Levi, Pepsi, Coke, it's all there. So I guess from the backlash of all that and the misconception of all that, we decided to document our third tour, which was last year, and we called the film Just Like Us. And there's a website, it's justlikeusthemovie.com, and it's really an eye-opener into the countries that we traveled to, which was going back to Egypt, Lebanon, Dubai, and we this time had gone to Saudi Arabia. and had done stand-up comedy in Saudi Arabia. Coincidentally enough, the same day we arrived, Barack Obama arrived in Saudi, so we thought it was kind of coincidental, and he ended up in our film, so by default. And but listening to all the speakers and Dr. Matawa and everybody speaking about failures, we failed quite a bit as comedians and actors, and there's a whole idea of taking responsibility and not waiting for the industry to change your image, because the industry will never change your image. You have to do it within. And I think somebody mentioned about embracing your culture and embracing your identity and not being afraid of it. And for several years, my agents and managers were telling me to change my name to Rick or Joe so I can go in for a 7-Up commercial audition or whatever it was. And I never wanted to change my name, Ahmed. I thought it was, you know, interesting, funny, and I could joke about it. So what ended up happening in all of this is we ended up sort of having a voice in the entertainment industry, but it's still not enough. We're still kind of being secluded in Hollywood and even in other parts of entertainment around the world, and I think it's just a great thing to see books like The 99 and, you know, some of these filmmakers and festivals and stuff that are starting to be created within the Muslim community, and it's really starting to reflect on the youth. Our film, Just Like Us, the tagline is a modern generation coming of age. And that's what we hope to prove and show when you hopefully get a chance to see the film, inshallah. But I guess from my own personal journey, and it's a big honor to be invited here and to speak here, and I'm just really grateful to be able to meet you all and to be here for this iftar dinner and for this celebration. And I think that if there's anything I can leave with all of you today is, you know, don't be afraid to speak your mind. Don't be afraid to be self-deprecating. And don't be afraid to, you know, make light of things that that need to be made, you know, aware of. I mean, I guess one of the things that happened with me personally as a stand-up comedian is the whole sensitivity issue with religion, what's funny, what's not funny. And that was a big lesson for me when I was traveling through the Middle East, what we were able to say, what we weren't able to say, being censored in certain countries such as Dubai, Lebanon, Dubai, Egypt, Kuwait. And being sensitive to the religion and people's feelings. And I think I see, is that Linda over there? Hi, Linda. Linda Haddad over there. She's in our film. And nice to see you. So again, I'm just grateful to be here. And if you get a chance, check out our website. The movie hopefully will come out hopefully soon, and depending on distribution. But we're grateful for the opportunity for the people that have seen the film and have changed their mind on the Middle East and on Islam just based on 72 minutes of documented proof that Arabs and Muslims can laugh just like us here in America. That's the title of the film. So, Assalamu alaikum. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ahmed.